Neil deGrasse Tyson, welcome. I'm delighted to get the chance to talk to you, and I am... This is a happy coincidence. I was going to wear that exact tie.
No, you were not. You were lying.
I promise you, I do not have a tie like that in my closet.
I got about 110 ties. Each one is sort of uniquely capturing some aspect of the universe as imagined, or rather as felt, through the eyes of an artist.
I want to start with your latest book, Starry Messenger, Cosmic Perspectives on Civilization. In your book, you use the device of saying, what would an alien say?
Yes.
If they came here to Earth from outer space,
yeah,
and they saw our wars, our politics, as you say, our inability to distinguish fact from opinion. So what do you think said alien would say?
So the alien comes upon Earth, beautiful blue marble, orbiting the sun, and there's oceans and land and clouds. And then they learn that there's a species that has spread itself across all of the land. They say, oh, that's a very productive, very successful species. And then they come down and they say, oh, wait a minute, that same species has drawn lines on this otherwise contiguous set of land masses, and these lines, you can't cross them unless you have special papers. Not only that, they've divided themselves by who they worship, what their skin color is, what their how they dress, where resources are and where they're not, on a level where they will even commit violence, even all-out war.
But we do have real differences. We do have serious differences between nations, between political parties. Are we just supposed to say from a cosmic perspective they don't matter?
No, no. In fact, the differences enrich the plurality of a nation, especially of a free nation. So, no, I don't want to get rid of differences. I want to get rid of differences that, at their fundamental level, are not different. You think they're different because you've dug your heels into some opinion that is malformed based on what you think is true. That's different from us agreeing what is objectively true and then sitting down and say, oh, what do you think about this? And then you share your point of view with me, as do I. And you say, oh, that's interesting. I hadn't thought about it that way. Oh, is there a way we can resolve this?
You have carved out a unique place for yourself in our intellectual life these days. And I think, I don't know if you're going to object to this, I would describe it as the pop scientist. Here you are on one of your many shows, Cosmos, Possible Worlds. Take a look.
Every month represents about a billion years. Every day represents nearly 40 million years. That first day of the cosmic year began with the Big Bang, almost 14 billion years ago. Nothing really happened in our neck of the universe until about 3 billion years later, March 15th of the cosmic year, when our Milky Way galaxy began to form.
How did you decide on this role? And do you get pushback from, and I say this advisedly, serious scientists?
That pop scientist role had already been carved by Carl Sagan. And whatever sort of blood on the tracks that left, I remembered hearing about this, that he was chastised by some of his colleagues for appearing on The Tonight Show with Johnny Carson. And this is a show that had huge reach into the tax-paying public. So at some level, we have a duty, if not an obligation, to bring some of that back to the public. And yeah, when I'm writing a book, I'm not doing the research paper, right? So there's a trade-off often in that. But no, I still have strong taproots into the research community.
You were involved in the effort to demote Pluto. You even appeared on my favorite science show, Big Bang Theory.
Oh.
Here it is.
I'm quite familiar with Dr. Tyson. He's responsible for the demotion of Pluto from planetary status. I liked Pluto. Ergo, I do not like you.
But I actually didn't demote Pluto. That was a vote of the International Astronomical Union.
If ifs and buts were candy and nuts, we'd all have a Merry Christmas.
Is it true?
For the evidence, I can't act, really, but...
No, I thought you did very well
there. I did okay there? Yeah.
Is it true that you got hate mail for dissing Pluto?
Oh, yeah. I have a file cabinet this deep. Hate mail from third graders.
Listen, when I...
Third graders!
Well, third grade, I learned how you could tell the planets from their distance from the sun. Mary's violet eyes make John stay up nights, period. Period. Pluto. Now there's no period.
Yeah, so deal with it. I'm just saying.
All right, in a minute.
Yeah.
Why is Pluto not a planet?
Oh, Pluto's orbit is tipped, significantly tipped out of the plane of orbits of the other planets. By the way, you know what else has tipped orbits? Comets. Okay? More than half of Pluto's volume is comprised of ice. If you brought Pluto to where Earth is now, heat from the sun would evaporate that ice and it would grow a tail. That's no kind of behavior for a planet.
Do you believe that there is life out there somewhere?
I would say that if there weren't life, it would be astonishing. If given how common our ingredients are and how quickly life took place here and how many planets we know are orbiting host stars.
And
it would be astonishing if that were the case.
And what about aliens and what about UFOs?
Well, to me, any life is alien. You mean aliens like with antennas and ray guns?
Something more than a cell.
Okay. Something that could land here in a spaceship. It could be out there. There's no evidence that would convince an authentic skeptic that we've been visited. And I can tell you this, these fuzzy, monochromatic tic-tacs that show up on the Navy restricted airspace in our own atmosphere. By the way, you've seen the high-resolution images from a telescope we parked a million miles from Earth called the James Webb Space Telescope, looking at the edge of the universe. And the best you have of visiting aliens in our own atmosphere is a fuzzy tic-tac. You got to do better than that if you're going to convince an astrophysicist.
Your story begins when you're 9 years old, and like every school kid in New York City, including me, you go to the Hayden Planetarium. But the difference is it changed your life. Why?
Yeah, so sometimes I wonder, had I grown up on a farm somewhere, whether I wouldn't have been as starstruck as I was. Because there I am, a kid having grown up in the Bronx.
Right.
You sit in the chair, the lights dim, the stars come out, and it was more stars than I'd ever seen in my life. It was a hoax, for sure. I know how many stars are in the night sky. There's six visible from the Bronx. That was the night sky. No one in New York City has any kind of relationship with the night sky.
That's true. When you go out into the real world, it's like, what are all those lights
there? What are all those lights? So there they dim the lights, and I'm struck by it. Whereas, had I seen that every night of my life, this would just be, of course, this is just the night sky. So this, it hit me. So I don't think I chose the universe. I think the universe chose me.
You talk about your journey, and you've used this phrase as the path of most resistance, a young black kid from the Bronx becoming an astrophysicist. How tough was that path, and how important do you think it has been for people of color to see Neil deGrasse Tyson in the place that you occupy?
I will invert that and say, how important is it for white people to see me where I am? That's a way more important force operating, especially if that is the community that wields resources and opportunities. And if you see a black homeless person in the street and you never saw a black academically achieved other human being, you're prone to say, oh, that's just their lot in life. But now you'll see me and you'll see the black homeless person and you have to like deal with that. It's like, oh my gosh, there but for the lack of opportunity goes, you know, you get
a lot of people.
A lot of people. So I just want to put that up front. It was a path of most resistance because, yes, I was also physically fit and athletic. And you see a black person who is that, particularly in the day, it's, you should be an athlete. And that just simply fulfills people's bin that they would put you because they've never seen your kind do anything else. And my father, who was active with the civil rights movement and a sociologist, he had way worse life encounters than I did dealing with society, and he was never bitter. He said, these people don't know better. And so I've carried that with me ever since. I've never been bitter. It just is, and I'll deal with it. It's force to have me achieve that much more, to the extent that that ever becomes visible and will matter to anyone.